We're back. Another sentimental journey. We took some time off, showed some reruns, but now it's time to get back to our regular shows. And I know you people out there have been waiting for this. So right now, we've got a special show for you tonight. And what I want to do is introduce my special guest. One of our newcomers to the show, to my far right, is Gary Dombrowski. Gary grew up on Villa Road. And Gary's very well versed in the subject that we're going to talk about tonight. To my right here, recently, last year, inducted into the Shrewsbury High Basketball Sports Hall of Fame, and I always say, purest shooter I've ever seen at Shrewsbury High, Guy Ferranti. I'm Henry Grandpietro, the host of the show, and this good-looking guy right here, probably one of the best-looking guys in the whole town. I mean, he was voted best-looking, is Paul Bianchi. So, what we're going to get into tonight, and this is a show that I've been wanting to do for a while. If you think about it, you know, we're all so lucky today, and it's kind of commonplace. We have the Red Sox winning. We have the Patriots winning every year. We have duck boat parades. We have everything. But it wasn't always that way. In fact, the Patriots came into existence in 1960, but we didn't take them seriously. Our team was the New York Giants because every weekend we used to get their games.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Now, Gary, I want to ask you, what was your first impression when you heard that the American Football League had started?
I had no really thought about them, but I really didn't like the NFL as it was because it was like your father's team.
Yeah.
And you wanted your teams. Just like the Celtics won so much when we were young that I thought it was time to have your team. And so the Patriots came. It was interesting because it was somebody different.
Yeah.
You know? And
so, well, I guess what I want, when did you actually... You were a Giants fan.
Yeah.
We all were. When did you feel that you actually transferred over to being a Patriots fan and kind of threw the Giants aside?
Well, I think really what happened, like when Namath came along, they played the first Super Bowl in 67. Okay, we knew that the Packers were going to just kill them, which they did. But then come the third year with Joe Namath, he had the big mouth, the white shoes. And they, you know, they had their names. They had like emblems on their helmets. Yeah. They were flashy. You know, they had flashy uniforms. And you said, these guys are not going to win the Super Bowl. And he just had that Eubank. They had the coach had that little quick. So anybody near him, he had a little safety valve pass. Yeah. And off the guy went.
They beat him. They were 17-point favorites, the Baltimore Colts.
That was my next question.
Well, a backup quarterback. Johnny Unitas wasn't even playing.
That's when they were kind of like. Like a young version. The old NFL was like Gary said, your father's team. They wore black shoes and high-cut shoes. When these guys came on the NFL, they had low-cut shoes and emblems on their helmets and flashy uniforms. They were kind of a new breath of fresh air.
And ran the ball.
Yeah.
You know, the passing game was not sophisticated like it is today. Defense is not sophisticated like they are today. It was like almost mirrored the college game, which was 3 yards in a cloud of dust.
Yeah.
You know, and a pack of sweep. You know? What did Bart Starr throw the ball? 15 times a game?
Yep.
Well, you know, I was reading today on the internet, on the web, that Boston had a team going back to the 30s. Mm-hmm. They had the Boston Redskins.
Yep.
And they went from 33 to 36, and they didn't draw anybody. They played at Fenway Park. They drew nobody. So they moved to Washington. 44 to 48, they had the Boston Yanks played in Fenway Park. They didn't draw anybody. So when Billy Sullivan put the money up or wanted to get a franchise in this new AFL, a lot of people spoke against it because they didn't think football could go in Boston. They didn't think it would last. Well, as we know now, it certainly did last.
Yeah. Well, there weren't a lot of teams there. You know, they weren't each state didn't have a team, or each regional area didn't have a team like they have today. You know, we liked the Giants because they were closest to us.
Right. Now, the AFL had 8 teams. That's all they had.
Yeah.
They had the East. You had the Boston Patriots, the Buffalo Bills, the New York Titans, not the Jets, which are the Jets today, and the Houston Oilers in the East.
Yep.
And in the West, you had the Dallas Texans, which is the Kansas City Chiefs today, the Denver Broncos, the Los Angeles Chargers, And what's the other one? Denver Broncos.
Denver, right.
Denver Broncos. That was it. They had that was the... In the first 2 years, the Houston Oilers won the championship. George Blanda was the quarterback.
He was
a legend. I mean, he's a Hall of Famer.
And he was 33.
Yes.
Yeah. Like at that time, most of the quarterbacks were 30-year-old guys coming in. And the AFL was trying to grasp at any straw they could to get people. Like one of the first coaches of the Titans, Sammy Ball.
Yeah.
Sammy Ball was one of the first coaches. The Titans, they were awful.
Where did they play?
They played at...
they played at the Polo Grounds.
They did.
Polo Grounds,
they played at the old Giant, New York Giants, New York Baseball Giants Polo Stadium, the Polo Grounds.
Don Maynard was their top receiver. He was
old. Wasn't the first quarterback for the Patriots was Songin.
Butch Songin.
He played at BC, but wasn't he about 34 or 5 or 6 like that?
I'll tell you the story about Butch Songin. Butch Songin was an All-American in hockey in BC in 47 and 48. They won one of their championships. He was the quarterback of the Patriots when he was 33.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And to relate this to Shrewsbury, the team, the Marlboro Shamrocks, when LaCostia played, Skip Pimenta played.
Paul Jordan.
My brother played.
Duck.
They went down to New Jersey, played a team called the New Jersey Generals. Butch Songin was the quarterback. So he was 40 then, in 67.
Yeah.
And I don't know if the New Jersey Generals were owned by Trump then, but obviously that was Trump's team later.
Yeah.
But they were almost like a farm team for the Jets. They had several players that ended up making the Jets later, and they took this bus trip down there and played this team, the New Jersey Generals, and Butch Songin was the quarterback.
Yeah. Now, if I'm not mistaken, I think he was a World War II veteran. He came out of the service. He was in World War II. If he was 40 in 67...
You got to remember, Henry, we're only around 10 years old, so...
Right. Well, when the Patriots came into being, you were 10, I was 11. We were 11.
He was an All-American hockey in 47 and 48. They won a national championship in 47.
Wow. So that's when he came out of the service. I know he was, I'm pretty sure he was a World War II veteran. But he only played 1 year for the Pats.
Babe Parilli took over.
Yeah,
They traded for Parilli.
Yeah.
When they fired Saban, they traded for Parilli. Yeah.
Saban was only there 1 year.
And 61. And they had a good winning streak. They had a pretty good record when that famous play happened.
Was that Holovac came in?
Mike Holovac, second year.
I think it was the Texans. They were at BU, and the Texans had a fourth and goal with like 5 seconds to go, and all the fans were crowded around the end zone. It was fourth and goal. A guy ran out of the back of the end zone, a fan.
To the
middle linebacker slot, blocked the pass, and ran back into the crowd. The game was over.
Oh, wow. That's right. They played 1 year at Alumni Stadium. The Patriots.
They played, I know they played in 1969 at Alumni Stadium. From 64 to 68, they played at Fenway.
Fenway Park.
But
they played at Braves Field at the first 3 years.
Yeah.
Nickerson Field.
Called
the Braves
Field. The merger, I didn't realize this until I read it today. The merger actually took place in 1966. Did you know that? That's when they started playing.
Yeah.
But the actual signing took place in 1966 because...
Of the Super Bowl, Super Bowl?
The Super Bowl. Yeah. Plus, if you remember, the AFL was signing a lot of the stars off the NFL. They were robbing the NFL because they had big backers. They had big money. Lamar Hunt was an oil man.
Yes.
He had tons of money.
Yeah. Signed Billy Cannon. He was the first draft choice. Ron Burton was the first draft pick. The Patriots.
Burton was?
Yep.
Let's backtrack a little bit, because I'm getting too far into the Patriots.
Okay.
Now, as I said before, we were all New York Giants fans. Let's name some of the guys that were on that team. First of all.
Let's name the defensive line.
Okay.
Four of them were terrific. Dick Modjeleski.
Yeah.
Andy Robustelli.
Notre Dame, right? Modjeleski?
Yes. Andy Robustelli.
Yeah.
Jim Cabbage, and Rosie Greer. Those names just scared you. Just listen to those last names. Cat Cabbage, Robustelli.
We lived and died with the New York Giants.
Yeah.
And Sam Huff
was the middle linebacker.
He was an animal.
Yeah. Erich Bonds.
Del Schaaf, with Dick Lynch.
Jimmy Patton was a safety. Remember?
Jimmy Patton. Who was the kicker?
Chandler.
Was the kicker. Pat Chandler would fill in when Summerall wasn't there.
And who was the quarterback? Not Y.A. Tittle.
Charlie Connolly.
It was a good quarterback.
Here's a question for you. On the old Giants, who was the center?
Ray Whitehead.
That's right. Can't fool this guy.
And who was the offensive coordinator and defensive coordinator?
Tom Landry
and Vince Lombardi. And they didn't even hire. When that job came up, when Jim Lee Howell retired, do you think they would have took Lombardi or Landry?
They took
Ali Sherman.
Why? Why did they hire Lombardi?
I think it was a little bit discriminatory there.
Of course it was.
Being Italian.
He was told by the powers that were at the time, might have been the Mara family, you will never get the head coaching job at the Giants. And that's what he wanted. That was what Vince Lombardi wanted, what he was aspiring to be. And he said, why? He certainly knew the game because you've got a vowel at the end of your name. He was told that. So when he got when the Green Bay job opened up, he didn't even know what Green Bay was.
Green Bay was a terrible team.
Yeah.
He turned that whole franchise around.
He did. Talking about Green Bay, that was your favorite team.
My favorite. Well, yes. I was always a Packer fan. My dad was a big Packer fan.
And Bart Starr?
I love Vince Lombardi.
Who was tougher than Jimmy Taylor?
Oh, man. He was second, number two. Jimmy Brown was the greatest.
Jimmy Brown won a rushing championship, like, I think, nine years in a row.
He was the greatest running back.
The only guy that wrested that from him was Jimmy Taylor. He just died recently, by the way.
Yeah. Taylor was a very good power, like Larry Zonka type.
Yeah.
Fullback.
Yeah.
Right?
He didn't quit. He just kept coming at you. Yeah.
And they had Paul Harnack.
What was Taylor's size?
Well, they weren't very big.
They weren't maybe 220, 230. Yeah. Not even. Short, maybe, yeah. Maybe 5'10". Yeah.
The offensive linemen, I don't think they were probably 240, 250.
His goal was to run into people and then bounce off of them.
Yeah.
You know? Who was Taylor's running back partner?
Paul Harnack.
What happened to him?
Caught gambling.
Gambling, yeah. Notre Dame.
With who?
Alex Karras, right?
You know how much they were fined? $2,000. But they were banned for a year.
Yeah, yes. Couldn't play for a year. Yeah.
See, we just hit on this before, and I think you mentioned it too. The AFL was flashy.
Yeah.
The AFL had the names on the back of the uniforms. And did you know there was a quota? The old NFL? A quota? You know what I mean by quota?
What's that? What do you mean?
You could only have so many black players.
Oh, I didn't know that.
In the NFL. When the AFL, they took anybody that was a good ball player, which made for a more interesting league. Whereas the NFL, like, they had old black shoes on.
Yeah. That's...
Every play was a run. The other thing they stole from the AFL, or they took from the AFL, was the two-point conversion.
That's right. Yeah. The AFL had the two-point conversion.
Oh, when they merged, that was a big tussle when they merged.
I read that when they merged, they took that away for a while.
Yeah.
Then in 94, they reinstituted the two-point conversion. But when you think about it, the Patriots, I mean, everybody hates the Patriots now, except for us. The whole country hates the Patriots.
True. Yep.
Isn't that great?
Why shouldn't they?
They should.
Because they win all the time.
Yeah.
And did you ever think you would see this in your day?
No.
I don't think we'll ever see it again.
You probably won't. And if you think about it.
You'll never see another team like this.
No.
The era of the salary cap, now, you'll never see anything like it. Look at all the teams that just come into the Super Bowl. Win or lose the Super Bowl. A lot of them, they never... They're barely a good team the next year sometimes.
Right.
Look at Atlanta. Sometimes they fade away in 2 years.
Atlanta's never going to go back. What do you think?
Put the number on how many Super Bowl winners and losers the next year didn't make the playoffs or didn't have a winning record. It's you can't understand it. But you get happy, you get fat, you're in a circuit, everybody loves you, you don't work as hard.
That show that's on, I think it's Shannon Sharp, him and the other guy.
Skip Bayless.
Yeah. Shannon Sharp says the biggest reason why the Patriots have been successful is because Bill Belichick's fourth quarter defense, in any game, does not give up any points.
Right.
He said Brady comes back and wins the game through the offense, but they don't allow any points in the fourth quarter.
Mm-hmm. You know, when you think about it, the Patriots weren't always a good franchise, though. Do you know that the year before Belichick took over, actually, no, yeah, it was Belichick.
Well, Pete Carroll was there.
No, Parcells.
Oh, Parcells.
Year before Parcells took over, they were 1-15.
Mm-hmm. Rod Rust.
Was it Rod Rust?
Yeah.
And I think they were 6-something, 6-11 McPherson.
That's why Parcells took the job.
Right.
He wanted that number one overall pick. He wanted to be able to pick his guy at quarterback, and that's what he did.
But if, when they moved into Foxborough Stadium, to me, that's when they became a legitimate team.
I thought they were a legitimate team when Orthwine took over the team.
Well, that was after.
He brought in Parcells.
That was after, right. But when did you actually start following the Giants as opposed, the Patriots as opposed to the Giants?
Well, I followed them, let's go back to 1963. Don't forget now, they were in the AFL championship game. They got smoked by the Chargers, 59-10, I think. Yeah, but, 50, they did go to the AFL championship.
51-10 they got beat.
And in 66, they were one game away of making the playoffs. Yep. They could, if they beat the Jets, they would have been in. They would have played Kansas City, which could have been Super Bowl I. They had the MVP of the league, Jim Nantz. Babe Pearlie was an All-Pro player. They had quite a few good defensive players at that point. Geno led the league in scoring. Should be in the Hall of Fame. Yep. Geno Cappelletti.
Yep.
And
Jim Colclaw.
I mean, they had good receivers.
Larry Garen.
Geno Cappelletti was the leading scorer in the old AFL.
Yes, he was.
He was a career leading scorer. Yeah.
They had Larry Eisenhower and Houston Antoine.
Yes.
Remember in the line?
Yeah, Jim Hunt.
The Earthquake. Jim Earthquake Hunt.
The biggest guy in that line was Eisenhower. He was 270.
Yeah.
There's a story about him. In Kansas City, he came out in warm-ups because he was known as a crazy man. Came out with just his helmet and athletic supporter on.
Tell the people the story about Bob Gladio.
Bob Gladio was a pretty good player at Notre Dame.
Yeah.
Played with the Patriots on and off. I think he got cut or he wasn't active that day. It was in Yale, Harvard Stadium, excuse me.
Yeah, Harvard Stadium.
He was in Harvard Stadium. Him and his buddy had a couple of beers. His buddy went down for some more beers. He could hear over the announce Bob Gladio report to the Patriots locker room. He went down there. His buddy came down, didn't know where he was. All of a sudden, the kickoff happened, tackled by number 24, Bob Gladio. You
know? Yeah, when they first started the league, they had a bunch of guys like from BC. Well, what's his name? Bob D.
Yeah. John Morris.
Yeah, they didn't have
Tom Hennessy.
John Morris was an AFL player.
Yes, he was.
The caliber of players was not like in the NFL, but.
Well, I mean.
But they had some good running back. Jim Nance was a hell of a running back.
There were a couple of teams.
Well, after the third or fourth year, then they could beat the NFL after the third or fourth year.
Well, I told that story before we got on the air that the NFL champions was Chicago Bears, 1963.
Yeah.
And they were challenged to a game by the San Diego Chargers, who had Lance Allworth, John Hadle, and
Tobin Rowe.
Tobin Rowe. But who were the running backs?
Paul Lowe, Keith Lincoln.
Bears said, no, we're the NFL champs. That's the way it works.
Mm-hmm.
You're an upstart league. That fall, in some, you know, when they before the leagues, before the spring training, what you would call spring training, preseason, they challenged the Bears to a game, and I guess they wiped the field with them.
Mm-hmm.
And now we know why the Bears didn't want to play. One of the things that they used to have.
You had some innovative coaches, like you had
Hank Stram.
Sid Gilman.
Who's the guy for the
Al Davis.
Not Davis. He was an owner, but the Madden.
Johnny Madden.
They had good teams.
Johnny Madden, San Diego,
that was Sid Gilman.
Sid Gilman.
He was a well-known offensive guy that made a lot of different things.
Now, before they played the first Super Bowl,
yep,
we were all excited about it. We couldn't wait to see it. How do they compare against the real NFL players?
Green Bay Packers.
Yeah.
They got smoked.
What did you think going into that game?
I don't know. I thought the Packers. I thought it'd be a closer game than it was.
Yeah.
But I thought the Packers.
Max McGee.
I mean, like this.
Yeah. And again.
Walking away. Running away.
Did you think that? I didn't think the AFL had a chance.
No, because they didn't have the time 3 or 4 years to bring any decent players
right.
in. That was their problem.
Right. And if you look at it, when Namath played, when he made a prediction, we're going to win. People thought he was nuts.
Well, look when he came in, though. Gary and I just talked about it the other day. In 65, they drafted
John Hewitt.
Hewitt from Notre Dame.
Heisman Trophy winner.
Yeah, and they had...
Oh, Hewitt, that's right.
Yeah, and Namath. Those two were on the Jets, drafted at the same time, and they fought it out for the job. So you that's when the quality of players started to come into the league.
Well, remember the contract they offered to Namath, $400,000?
Yeah.
That was unheard of. Can you imagine what the veterans in the NFL were thinking?
But you have to understand, the attendance when they first started was like 12, 13,000 in the NFL. Right. It was like 50,000 in the NFL.
Right.
But after that third Super Bowl, you that know, when Namath came along, you know.
I think it was 1960. Jimmy Brown, I could be wrong, Jimmy Brown was the NFL MVP. And Ted Williams on 59. Ted Williams was making $100,000. Jimmy Brown was making $35,000. The disparity in monies... Because baseball back then was everything.
It was bigger than football.
It was
bigger. Oh, definitely. Now it's the other way around.
It was bigger than everything.
Right. No, but they didn't make big money either, though.
No, they no. Well, no, not like now.
Burrow,
now it's ridiculous.
Burrow in 53, he won what, the MVP or the triple?
MVP,
That year he was MVP and he was making $29,000. Well, you know, sell used cars in the offseason.
Well, the problem with that was the Yankees were notoriously cheap. Yeah. They were cheap. So they would depend on their World Series money to make ends meet, a lot of those guys. And, you know, but the NFL... they had no choice but to merge it because the AFL was upcoming. They could have wiped the NFL out at one point because they had the money behind them. So I think that...
They had some rich owners. Not Billy Sullivan, but they had some rich owners.
Yeah, he was the only...
You know how much it cost him?
$25,000 to buy a team.
They were the last team. Lamar Hunt let them in the last ones. And they thought that... I think let's talk about 1976.
We'll go back to Kraft now. Kraft, when did he buy the team?
94.
He paid $175 million.
Yep.
Now it's worth $3 to $4 billion.
Yeah.
So, you know, you're talking about...
Yeah, football's strong.
Where that came from.
And his wife, Myra, went bananas on him. She said, that's all the buildings, the businesses we have, that's it. And think about it. The Patriots were a struggling organization when he bought it. They were struggling.
They were.
Yeah.
They were.
Offline, they were ready to go. They were going to be the St. Louis Stallions.
Yes.
They had the logo. They had hats printed up. At the last minute, I'll never forget this. I pulled up to Shrewsbury High School, picking up my daughter from school. She was a senior. And I'm listening on the radio, thinking all along they're gone. I mean, didn't you think that?
Absolutely.
Yeah. You thought it was a foregone conclusion.
Yeah.
Millionaire businessman, local millionaire businessman, Bob Kraft, has just purchased the New England Patriots for a reported... unheard of, $172 or $175 million.
$175 million.
Because he owned the land that the stadium was on.
Right.
Foxborough Racetrack.
And he said after, the reason he bought the Patriots is because he was 11 years old when the Boston Braves left. And it broke his heart because he never wanted to see a team leave a city. Well, I'll tell you, thank for him because we've had so much fun with that team. But let's go. We've got 5 minutes. We still got 5 minutes left. 1976. Do you remember what happened that year?
Oh, Patriots got robbed. Oh.
Everybody ben still Dreyf. Remembers the referee's name.
Ben Dreyf.
I didn't remember that.
Yeah.
Was it a rough in the passer call? Yeah.
Who was the guy that roughed him up? Supposedly.
Sugar Bear
Hamilton.
He actually tipped the ball and then hit him. And, you know, it wasn't in a situation where it should have been called.
Yeah.
You know, and I think the NFL thought they owed Oakland one because the year before was the Immaculate Reception.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, which
Franco Harris
had the game pretty much won.
Right. Yeah.
You know?
I mean, do you think that, I don't say the Tuck rule, you think it was payback for 1976?
I
don't think so. You think so?
I think it would be. I do.
Yeah.
Al Davis got it in return.
Well, when you saw that happen, the Tuck rule back in, what was it? What year was that? 2001.
Yeah.
Or 2000, it was 2001. Right. Gary, did you think that was a fumble?
Yeah.
I thought we were done.
Oh, always been a fumble. Yep. You know, okay, they had a good year. You know, they came a long way. You know, Oakland was
they had
a really good team.
They were ahead most of that game. They were ahead in that.
Well, everybody said it's a snow game. Oakland is from California. They won't be able to play in it. They outplayed the Patriots.
They were ahead most of that game.
They were. They outplayed them just about the, every facet of the game.
That game might be one of the greatest wins for the Patriots of all time. That turned that whole franchise around.
It did.
It got them to the Super Bowl. That game, and they were losing that game.
They were losing that game. And when Vinatieri kicks the field goal in the blizzard.
Oh, yeah, that was a miracle.
How did they do that?
It's a miracle.
The Rams.
You know, over the years, there were some crazy things that happened with the Patriots. Do you remember when a coach by the name of Clive Rush?
Yep.
Clive
yes.
Rush?
Yeah.
He hired Johnny Mazur.
Yeah.
For head coach.
He became a coach, yeah.
He was general manager.
Yeah. Right.
And Rush got up to the microphone to introduce Johnny Mazur, right? He got electrocuted. Fell flat on the floor.
Oh, God.
It was almost like the franchise was snake bitten. They couldn't do anything right. Remember Randy Vataha?
Yeah.
Who was all world?
Yeah. Russ Francis?
Russ Francis. I remember one time we were watching the game. He fell on the football. He was out for 6 weeks. My father says, 6'6", 240 pounds. He falls on the football. He's out for 6 weeks. He
said, hey, how about the fire?
Oh, yeah.
The fire at Alumni Stadium.
Yeah.
The popcorn machine caught on fire under the bleachers. Caught the stands on fire. They put it out at halftime. They continued the game.
Well,
I don't know what happened with
them. They were bad for many,
they were
many
terrible.
Years.
Before the first game, before the very first game, they were running through plays at Nickerson Field. The Buffalo coach was sitting in the stands watching everything. He didn't even know it. He copied all the plays down.
At Fenway, the benches were side by side.
Yeah, they were.
They used to walk back and listen to them calling plays. You thought Spygate was something? They did that back then to
sure,
each other.
Sure.
And when they're at Fenway, both benches were on the same side of the field.
How about mentioning some quarterbacks in the old AFL?
Yeah.
Jackie Kemp for the Buffalo Bills.
Jackie Kemp was one of the first draft choices in the AFL.
Right.
Jackie, he played with San Diego for 2 years.
Yes, he did.
They had great records. Then he went to Buffalo, and then I think they drafted Hadle. Tobin Rhodes actually won that championship for him, but then he went on with Buffalo and had several good seasons with Buffalo. So he was one of the great players in the AFL history.
He was very good, yeah.
Because he actually, San Diego was good, pretty good the first couple of years.
We're forgetting another good quarterback, Len Dawson.
Oh, yeah, with the Dallas Texans.
Yes, he was with Dallas,
yeah,
Texans.
Dallas Texans. Yeah.
Then he went to Kansas City.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't realize that.
How about the undefeated season for the Dolphins?
Yeah.
Reese got hurt, and Marl came in.
Yep.
And he played, what did he play?
Yeah.
He played
10. Old veteran. He used to play with the Giants.
He played 14 games back then, so I think he might have played, maybe 8 or 9 of those games?
Well, we're going to get on that on the next show. We've only got 40 seconds left. So what I want to do is, I want to thank Gary Dombrowski, Guy Ferranti. I'm Henry Grampietro, Paul Bianchi. I want to thank you people for watching this journey back into time, talking about the old AFL and the New York Giants. Stay tuned, because we've got more of that coming your way. So next time we're on, which is going to be following this show, we're going to take you and us on another sentimental journey.